Hello, I'm Sydney Kohara. People across the nation are recycling and doing more and more to protect the environment, trying to keep their own communities healthy and thriving. But here in San Francisco, something extraordinary is happening, and people all over the world are taking notice. No region in the country is as green as the San Francisco Bay Area. Bay Area residents take pride in doing the right thing for Mother Nature, and San Franciscans in particular are redefining the terms recycle and repurpose. Today, around 80% of solid waste in San Francisco is being diverted from landfills and recycled, repurposed, or composted. Around 80%. In this half hour, we'll show you just how the city is achieving that astonishing number and looking to the future and its goal of zero landfill waste by the year 2020. But before we move forward, let's take a look back at the city's long and rich history of recycling and reusing. Most people think of recycling as a relatively new concept, started within the past few decades. But it's been going on for a lot longer than that, since the 19th century. Back then, immigrants came to Northern California in search of a better life for themselves and their families, many of them taking jobs other people didn't want. These immigrants took the lead in collecting garbage, scavenging, and selling reusable items to make a living. Those were the days of horse-drawn carriages. The men would work in teams of four, with one man in charge of rummaging through the large box they used for collecting. He'd pick out anything that could be reused and put the items in barrels at the back of the box. Over time, workers and residents started using burlap sacks and blankets as part of the collection process. Workers stacked them high and took them to sorting facilities so salvaged items could be processed for reuse. These scavengers rescued all kinds of items from the trash. They washed and resold bottles. They salvaged buttons and zippers from clothing. They used the cloth for linens, ranging from cleaning rags to Turkish towels. After World War II, lots of military clothing started showing up in the trash. Many of the scavengers took to wearing these fatigues, always looking to reuse and repurpose. The scavenging business passed down from generation to generation for decades. Today, some of those working in recycling in San Francisco are fifth-generation descendants of these hard-working immigrants. The efforts over the past century are not surprising given the Bay Area's values and overall desire to do the right thing, especially when it comes to the environment. But over the years, things have gotten a lot more sophisticated than these vintage trucks that you see here in Recology's Antique Truck Museum. In the 1970s, there was an explosion of environmental consciousness. Government and garbage collectors began to collaborate on new ways to minimize garbage and salvage as much as possible. Well, that partnership set in motion the changes that led to the state-of-the-art process in operation today. Right now, we're about to take you behind the scenes of that massive operation to show you the nuts and bolts of what happens to the things we discard every day. The three-bin curbside system used in San Francisco has proved exceptionally successful. The blue bin is for recycling. The green bin is for food scraps and yard trimmings. And the black bin is for trash. Anything in the black bin is destined for the landfill, and we want as little as possible to end up there. Many things can be recycled or reused, but if they end up in the landfill, they are gone forever. Later on in the program, we're taking you to the place known as Recycle Central, where the material from your blue bin ends up. You may recognize where I am right now, at what is often affectionately referred to as San Francisco's dump. Well, this is actually called the transfer station, where most of the 3,000 tons of material tossed every day comes to be processed. I think I'm looking pretty stylish in my reflective clothing, but everyone wears these jackets and vests, so the drivers of the trucks and heavy equipment will see them. Here, workers sort and process everything from garbage to e-waste, discarded clothing to furniture, construction debris to hazardous materials. Everything that can be repurposed is. The Perfectly Good program, as it's known, aims to keep many everyday items out of the black bin.
Material comes to us, and as our workers are recycling it, if they notice something that's still in good condition, like a chair or a chest of drawers or a kitchen table, they take that aside. We load those good items on a truck, and then they go back to St. Vincent de Paul, where they're cleaned up and painted and then they move into their thrift shops. And that is a form of reuse. It's just like reusing a metal water bottle or reusing a canvas tote bag. Now we're going to reuse a chest of drawers. We're going to reuse a kitchen table. So it never goes to a landfill. It never goes to a recycling plant. It doesn't produce pollution.
We also want to keep hazardous materials out of the black bin. Things like batteries, fluorescent light bulbs, paint, and cleaning chemicals. Here at the transfer station, residents of San Francisco can drop off all of these items free of charge.
Here is the place, you know, you can drop those things off before they cause harm to you and to the environment. We don't want none of those stuff to end up in a landfill and end up in our drinking water or end up in a bay. Among the material coming in at the facility, the bulk of it are paint-based products, latex paint and oil-based paint. Good paint will be put in 5-gallon bucket, we'll mix it, and we put them in a 5-gallon bucket. Anybody in San Francisco can come in, take them for free to paint their house, their school, their community, you know, what have you.
Workers are able to mix the paints into 3 colors, off-red, off-green, and white. Some of this paint goes to developing countries to be used in schools, community centers, and hospitals.
El Salvador, Mexico, Tonga, and we send it to Zambia, Mali, and Papua. So all of those places have received a paint.
Stay tuned to find out why some think composting your food scraps is the most important form of recycling you can do. Now, on to the material that does end up in your black bin. It goes here, in the pit. It's 15 feet deep. Trucks come in daily from San Francisco neighborhoods and tip in their loads. A bulldozer runs back and forth over the material to break up large pieces. It then pushes the material over the edge to a lower level, right into long-haul trucks that run the trash out to the landfill near Livermore, 58 miles south and east of San Francisco. In the next few years, Recology is hoping to transport landfill waste by rail. Rail hauling is much more efficient than trucking, saving fuel and reducing emissions. Keep in mind, the material in your black bin goes straight into the pit. It doesn't get sorted, and fully 1/3 of what ends up here doesn't even belong. It's up to San Francisco residents to sort their own garbage, recyclables, and food scraps.
We want to move away from landfills. We want to help cities break free of landfills. We want to get as many things possible recycled and composted, and this will just reduce our carbon footprint. We're going to do it in the most cost-efficient way possible.
We also want to keep construction debris out of the landfill. Builders and contractors bring materials in massive quantities here to the transfer station for processing. This part of the facility is called the Integrated Materials Recovery Facility, or IMRF. The construction materials are picked up and dropped onto a conveyor belt, where a shaker screen sifts out all the small rocks and dirt. That fine material is used for the covering needed daily at the landfill. Then come the bigger items. Scraps of sheetrock can be reworked into new sheetrock for other projects, and the material found in it called gypsum can be added to compost as a soil amendment. Metal pieces go to scrapyards and foundries where they're made into new metal products. Concrete and bricks are broken down, then used to make new concrete for road base. Workers sort through all these materials and more, e-waste, rigid plastics, wood, cardboard, and make sure they get into the right piles down below. They wear heavy-duty gloves and glasses for personal protection. Not surprisingly, seagulls are attracted to a site like this. So a falconer comes daily to fly his birds and scare off the gulls.
It's a predator-prey relationship where the predator is here and the prey is out there, and their instinct tells them that it's time to move out of the area because they're afraid that the predator is going to chase them away.
The falconer's birds are captive-bred birds, and they're trained specifically to fly around and scare the gulls away, but not harm them.
One of the reasons why we don't want the seagulls here is they get into the trash and they eat things that they shouldn't be eating. They are scavengers, but we don't want them to carry the trash off to the beach areas, which are right across the freeway, or into the neighborhoods. And they don't need to be eating things that will make them sick.
Moving on now to the green bin. every day, trucks haul in from the neighborhoods 600 tons of compostable materials. They bring it here to the Organics Annex. The material includes food scraps from homes and restaurants, yard trimmings, and food soiled paper.
This is some of the most important kind of garbage that there is. Why? Because this is where the nutrients are. This is where the carbon is. We need to get those nutrients and this carbon back onto farms. So we take this organic material and we turn it into compost, nutrient-rich compost. We make it in a way that preserves the nutrients and preserves the carbon in the finished compost. It's some of the best recycling being done in America.
Larger trucks haul this organic material to composting facilities. One of those facilities is located near Vacaville, called Jepson Prairie Organics. Upon arrival at JPO, the material is ground up and dumped into rows, then covered with tarps. Each row goes through three phases, with each phase lasting about 15 days. After that, the material is cured for 2 to 3 weeks. The finished compost goes out to local farms and vineyards.
Our process today is what is known as a negative aerated static pile. That system actually draws the air down through the mass and conveys that air out to a biofilter that, in essence, scrubs the volatile organic compounds out of the emissions into the air. And exhausting through a biofilter, we destroy in excess of 90% of those volatile organic compounds, which are your odorous compounds. And that's what helps reduce the odors and the impacts from a facility this size. We currently process 400 tons per day over a 7-day week average. Works out to about 110,000 tons, 120,000 tons a year that's processed at this facility annually. And that 110,000 tons in years past on an annual basis would have went into the landfill. And once it's in the landfill, it's pretty much gone forever. With the composting program, you take a waste that was formerly landfilled, convert it into a soil amendment that gets applied back out into the agricultural fields, the backyards, and keeps that material out of the landfill.
This goes right to the heart of the matter when it comes to your green bin. This is why it's so important to put your food scraps in there for composting. Food scraps in the landfill contribute significantly to the production of methane gas. Municipal solid waste landfills are the third largest source of methane emissions generated by humans in the United States. Methane gas is a greenhouse gas, meaning it's very harmful to the environment. For farmers, compost provides a green alternative to chemical fertilizers and many other benefits, such as nutrient-rich soil and water retention. Kathleen Inman of Inman Family Wines is a farmer and a winemaker near Santa Rosa, and she uses compost from JPO every year.
Every spring, when I think the rains have finished, I come through the vineyard with a tractor that has special implements on it to do under the row weeding. And once I've gone through with the weeder, the next day I follow with a compost spreader. And that spreads a band right underneath the grapes. Throughout the growing season, you can see the compost sitting on the surface. And as I say, that has the added benefit of not just keeping weeds from growing under the vines, but it also keeps the moisture that's in the soil.
Kathleen has 10 and a half acres in the Russian River Valley. She farms it organically and runs a very sustainable operation. She uses solar power, and the building on her vineyard was built using virtually all recycled materials, from the frame of the building to the bar in the tasting room. Using compost instead of chemical fertilizers is part of what she calls her eco-ethics.
Which is the most important to me, the value that it has for the plants, which is obviously, as a winemaker, I want to grow the best grapes I can so that I can make the best wine that I can. But I'm also, you know, as a mother and a citizen, I really like the idea that I'm putting to use something that would have been going into landfill and causing even more problems. And it's fun now when I have people from the San Francisco city area come into my tasting room at the winery, and I find out they're from the city. I always say, so do you compost? And you know, you helped me create this Olivet Grange Pinot Noir. And if I didn't have you doing that, I wouldn't be able to grow it in quite the same way.
If you live in a part of the Bay Area where composting is not available to you, talk to your local officials about adding a green bin to the system. Now let's talk about the blue bin. We throw all of our glass, plastic, cans, aluminum, and paper into this bin. These items do not go through the transfer station. In San Francisco, they go straight to Recycle Central at Pier 96 in Bayview Hunters Point. To say that Recycle Central is a well-oiled machine is an understatement. It's a massive operation that combines modern equipment with old-fashioned hand sorting to get through the 750 tons of recyclables that arrive here every day. Trucks fresh off their routes pull in here to the tipping floor where they unload their material. Loaders send the materials on their way through the lines, where machines and people do all the sorting. Workers pull out any trash or non-recyclables. Then this machine sends paper up, and anything heavier, such as aluminum and plastic, down. The materials are sorted into 16 different commodities, including glass, paper, cardboard, hard plastics, and metals. These commodities are baled. Aluminum bales weigh about 800 pounds. Paper bales, 1,600 pounds. Workers on forklifts load them into containers, which are then shipped to domestic and international manufacturing companies that include foundries, glass plants, and paper mills. More than 30 large containers leave Recycle Central 6 days a week. The plant is the largest shipper of waste paper on the West Coast.
I've been working here for 12 years. I started off in customer service. I came over here 5 years ago to Recycle Central. So it's been a great job, a great experience.
At Recycle Central, most of the employees are from Bayview Hunters Point. Parts of this neighborhood have experienced astronomical unemployment rates over the past several decades. Today, Recycle Central officials have made good on their promise to employ people from Bayview. The jobs not only provide local workers with a steady income and crucial benefits, they also provide growth, a sense of stability, and a sense of purpose and pride.
Growing up in Bayview, we haven't had a lot of opportunities, a lot of job options. So, you know, a lot of our kids were just out there. And this gave me a chance of life, changed my whole outlook on different cultures, on everything. I've learned so much. I've been stable with my daughter, sending her through college. She's third year, graduate next year, 2013. I wouldn't be able to have my pretty teeth that I have today. My daughters wouldn't be in the health they are if it wasn't for the medical benefits we have with this company.
A lot of things changed in my life. A lot of things changed in my life financially. A lot of goals that me and my wife wanted to accomplish, we accomplished those goals. 2009, we bought our first house. Been real stabilizing, and it plays a big part in the kid's life to see where their father living, you know, that he gets up, he go to work, and he's being responsible.
A 2011 study prepared by the nonprofit TELUS Institute says, if the nation could increase its recycling rate from 33% to 75% by the year 2030, another 1.5 million jobs in the industry would be created. So recycling is not just good for the environment. It's a key player in the economic health of our nation. If more American cities would adopt San Francisco's model, a huge economic stimulus would result.
And other regions around the country are paying attention. They're starting to wake up to this great recycling movement here in the San Francisco Bay Area.
Recology is looking to some of the most creative and diverse minds in the Bay Area to inspire all of us to repurpose. I'm here in the sculpture garden at the transfer station. These works of art stand in stark contrast to all the trash, construction debris, e-waste, and food scraps that are regularly processed here. Yet they encourage us to look at the items we discard in a different way. Commissioned artists work here at the transfer station through an artist-in-residence program. They comb through viable discarded material and create diverse works of art. Six Bay Area artists are selected annually, and they work in an on-site studio for about 4 months. They finish their residency with an exhibition. Christina Maza is one of those artists.
At first, I saw a lot of construction material coming through, and it took a while before I started to see some of the other more personal items coming through. And I think the thing that strikes me the most is the volume of reusable materials coming through the dump and slated for the landfill. And it made me feel good as an artist to have materials to work with for my craft, but then also to know that I was repurposing those materials, that they were not going to be going to the landfill, that they'd be turned into something really beautiful and something that would intellectually connect with the public.
After the residency is complete, artists leave behind a piece or two to be permanently displayed at the transfer station's Environmental Learning Center or in the sculpture garden.
One of the pieces that I created during my residency was I found two shipping crates. They were vintage shipping crates, and they were absolutely beautiful. And I pulled the crates out of the dump and took them to the studio. They sat around for 2 or 3 weeks until I finally decided to draw on the surfaces, leave the crates intact, and create a story out of those crates. And the idea was that the children would be saying to the viewer, you know, notice me, look at me, I'm discarded, but love me. See the beauty and innocence in me. When I got into the program, obviously, I saw a lot of discarded pieces, and I really started, as I began to concept my show for the end of the 4-month period, I began to have a deeper understanding of what my work was about. And what it was about was discard followed by redemption, meaning things that are put to the side, things that people don't notice, the insignificant, brought into my work, brought into view of the public, and made to look beautiful, made to have a moment to shine, and to be redeemed in that process.
The Artist in Residence program aims to inspire all of us to think differently about our own consumption and how we can repurpose items we might otherwise throw away.
The people of a community determine just how successful a recycling program will be, but there's always room for improvement. Joining me is Heidi Obermeit, who can take a look at some of these household items that we've put together here and determine which bin they actually belong in. And Heidi, I can see this is pretty much recycling that goes into a blue bin, right? Or blue bin, I should say, for some communities. Other communities, it's different colors.
Correct. Everything here can go into the recycle bin.
But I see something like this, a box. A lot of us get things in the mail, so the box can go, but what about what's inside?
Yeah, so if you get packaging materials such as styrofoam, or if you have any kind of plastic film, that should be taken out and it should go into the landfill.
Okay, glass, this is pretty usual. We know that goes in. This is a drinking glass though, is that different?
So glass melts at different temperatures. So most cities only take glass bottles and jars. So if you have a drinking glass, that should go into the garbage if you break it.
Aluminum cans, we know they go in, but what about aluminum foil, and especially if you have food in here?
Yeah, so that's okay if you have a little bit of food stuck on the foil. What you want to do, just make sure that it stays clean and doesn't get the paper and cardboard messy, so just roll it up into a nice little ball and toss it in.
Okay, and make sure it's a pretty big ball though, right?
Yeah, we want to make sure it gets captured and doesn't fall through the screens.
Okay, good idea. We take a look at these plastics. We know what to do with these, but this one sometimes confuses me, these little fruit baskets.
Yeah, so every city is a little different in terms of the plastics that they accept. In San Francisco, all rigid plastics can go into the recycle bin.
All right, this is my favorite part. I know where this goes. Heidi, let's take a look at what goes into a compost bin. And I know in some communities, you can only put yard trimmings, plants, leaves, things like that, but I see you have food here.
Yeah, more and more communities are starting to take food scraps and soiled paper into their compost bins as well. And we have a saying that anything that used to be alive can go into your green bin, compost bin.
What about this paper, though?
Yeah, so where does paper and cardboard come from?
Oh, that's right, trees.
Yep.
Okay, so we can put this in. These are pretty obvious. Napkins, but you take a look at paper plates and things, and now you know these plates are coming in sort of wood. You can put all paper plates in?
Yes, all paper plates and any kind of untreated wood is fine, including chopsticks.
Okay.
I'll go in there as well.
This confuses me, though, when you talk about coming from something alive, because I would think plastic.
Yeah, so it looks just like plastic, but it's actually made from cornstarch.
How do you know that?
So you have to turn it over. If it says compostable, that means it can go into the compost.
Okay. So this is the same thing as this compostable cup. Now, I know pizza boxes. What about these?
Yes, so if your paper is dry and clean, it should go in the recycling. If it has food on it, if it's food soiled, it goes in the compost. So if you open it up
and you have your pizza here,
pizza, and it's greasy and there's cheese stuck on there, you would want to put this into the compost.
And the other part?
And if this is clean, you can throw that into the recycling, but you know, it comes from trees, so you can throw that into the compost as well.
Oh, Heidi, the dreaded black bin. Everything that goes in here goes to landfill, right?
Correct. Unfortunately, we haven't figured out how to process these materials yet, and so they have to go into the garbage.
The plastic, if you have bubble wrap, that goes in. Styrofoam. But wait a minute. Take a look at this. I would think you could recycle something like this.
Yeah, so if you look carefully, this is actually cardboard on the outside, okay, and then it has a plasticky foil liner on the inside. Yeah, so any kind of product that has multiple materials fused together, we can't really do much with that, so it needs to go into the landfill.
I wish we didn't have to do that.
I wish that was the case, too. Hopefully someday we'll figure it out. We are working on different solutions to figure out how to process these materials.
Maybe one day soon.
These day-to-day sorting activities can lead to the extraordinary reality of zero waste. Small steps make a big difference.
Working with the city of San Francisco, we have developed a system that could absolutely be replicated in any other urban environment where there's a political will.
It's that garbage and landfills are a complex problem. You know how you solve a complex problem? You bring a combination of solutions to it. Source reduction, efforts not to make so much garbage to begin with, recycling, then reuse, canvas carry bags, metal coffee mugs. Then you have composting, which is tremendously beneficial, tremendously effective at helping benefit the environment. And then there's something called producer responsibility. So if we can get manufacturers to be more environmental in how they design and make products, so you can take 4 or 5 or 6, and we're even looking at new solutions. And you start to bring these all together, and all of a sudden you can see that it is possible to really get very close to zero waste, to not needing landfills.
The Bay Area has a long history of innovation, so it's no wonder that right here in our own community, a vision for a greener earth has taken shape. Let's all pledge to redouble our efforts to reduce, reuse, and recycle for ourselves and for generations to follow. The children of tomorrow are counting on us to do the right thing. I'm Sydney Kohara. Thanks for watching.